All right, I would like to introduce David Ciccarelli, the creator, or you might say the proponent of Max for a long time already. I know David, I've met him only a couple of years ago, but I know him already for a long time, because when I just started working at STEM, I was introduced to a company which was called Intelligent Music, and this was the end of the 80s of last century, and David was one of the co-founders of that company, and he had written a couple of programs which basically completely blew me away at that time, and they were different from the traditional MIDI software that was available at that time, because at that time computers basically could do just MIDI stuff. And most of the MIDI stuff was either voice editors for synthesizers or traditional sequencers. But David had written two programs, one called Gem Factory, the other was M. And besides what you could do with the software, I was also very much inspired by the whole user interface. He has been a great source of inspiration for me. So I'm really happy that after all these years, finally he is here at STEM, and he will tell you some more stuff about, of course, Max and then version 5, which has been released not that long ago. Please welcome.
Exciting for me to finally be here after hearing about STEM for 25 years and thinking that, you know, this is a place it seemed to share the ideas I had, and so I'm happy that it's finally opened up enough that I could come here. And I didn't expect to come here as a person speaking. I'd just like to have checked it out, so that's also fun, and hopefully I won't embarrass the organization with this speech, and I'll be able to come back just as a visitor or something. And I'm not setting high expectations for myself. I wanted to talk less about what you can do with Max that's really cool, and more about what I think about when I work on the program. So I hope that's interesting to someone. So basically, imagine that you're faced with my job, which is to maintain a complex piece of software that has thousands of users, and lots of people have ideas of what I should be doing. How do I decide what to do? And I thought I'd try to answer that question. So the first thing is that there are basically three really boring criteria that I would use. The first one is, do I need to do something about something that's currently really embarrassing? And because the program isn't working and crashing or something like that. So that one's fairly obvious and not that worth talking about any further, but certainly is most of what I have to deal with every day. So that tells you already that everything else that I'm going to talk about is basically a distortion of reality, in the sense that my job is actually really boring. The second one would be sort of is it painfully necessary? And in particular, one big aspect of Max 5 is that we had to kind of rewrite most of the program from scratch because it was based on 1980s Mac OS APIs that aren't supported anymore, and then the Windows version was emulating the Mac, and that was even worse. We really had to start over in a lot of ways. And then the third thing is to question, since we have a certain number of people using the software, we can't really ruin their lives. And that is a big drag, because as a programmer, you really want to just get rid of certain things and not have to deal with them anymore, and that creates a lot of anger and bad feelings, so you don't want to do that. So those are sort of the three things that are mostly confronting me all the time, but I actually wanted to talk about something else, which is sort of more visionary and conceptual. So while I could sum up the first three things as just let's try not to give people a hassle. The other thing is that it's more than just fixing bugs, really. And in particular, a lot of people teach the program, and a lot of people learn the program. And when I was a teacher, and when I was in graduate school, my experience was that it was far harder to get the students to use this computer than it was to get them to program the computer. So I actually think programming is relatively easy for people. It's using the computer that's really a problem. So with the work that I've been trying to do recently, what I've been concerned with is just the stupid excuse that you would have for not even getting to the assignment that you would have as a student. In other words, there's just a problem getting started. And part of that was, how are you going to read the documentation? Well, we have tutorials, and in order to read the tutorials, you either have to print them out, which just wastes paper, or you have to somehow negotiate the screen so that there's a PDF document on one part of the screen and the program is on the other part of the screen, but usually you're using a laptop and there's no way you can get both of them to be on the screen at the same time. So then what's the program look like when you start it up? Do you know what to do first, where to find the documentation, that sort of thing. What are the tutorials like? Do they require a MIDI keyboard that no one has anymore? So that was a big concern. We basically converted all of the documentation into this XML-based format. And you'll see more of why I think that's important in a moment, but one aspect of revising the documentation is that we went and, with my coworker Luc Dubois, rewrote all of the Mac's tutorials to reflect what people are normally going to have, which is basically nothing but their computer in a modern setting. The other thing that that I wanted to do was look at how people actually use computers successfully now. And the main thing that people do with computers is use a web browser. So they're used to the user interface of a web browser, which means that there's some kind of toolbar, that they use search to find information and not expect to understand the structure of the existing documentation. And the other program that people use all the time is iTunes, which means that they expect that there's going to be a database of the things that they care about, and that they should be able to manipulate that database in some way that's meaningful to them. And finally, which is, again, extremely boring, and it's an incredible hassle, but we had to convert the program to use Unicode, which took 1,000 times longer than I thought it would. but I think this is really important, especially for our users in Asia. And I'm really happy that just this month, we're our distributor in Japan is releasing a version of Max that's been where all the user interface has been translated into Japanese. And I mean, I don't know whether they did the documentation or not, but it is possible to change a lot of elements of the program, which are just stored in a file now that you can change, and then it should adapt itself on both the Mac and Windows. So all of this is just designed to ensure that a user who might be interested in the program or being forced to use it because they're taking a class at least has a chance to get to the point where they're dealing with the interesting thing about the program, which is programming. And there's so much more that you can do in this area. And to me, it's sort of just giving your giving yourself a chance for people to find out what you're about. And it's not interesting, but it's, you know, necessary. Okay, so say that you've gotten to the point where you've overcome all those stupid barriers to just using the program. How do I think about what you think you're doing? So in other words, let's look at the question of creative work and how you might do it in software. So that has sort of become my primary interest. I think sound synthesis and video and controllers are cool, but I'm not very good at that kind of thing, and I think I'm better at thinking on a more abstract level, so I hope that that won't disappoint you, that I'm not going to show you some great demo, but the demos I'm going to show you are more about this cognitive aspect of being creative, which is what I'm really passionate about. So I want to give you an idea of how I think about how people do this work that we all do, which is basically that we're all liars, and that our main goal is to deceive people, and in deceiving other people, we have to deceive ourselves. And in order for software to be a part of this process, the software has to facilitate what I would like to call the cycle of deception. And I'm going to show first a patch they wrote in about 5 minutes, and sort of insulting that it took me that long. It should show you how I'm trying to fool you into what a cool person I am. And So basically, this, let me make it a little bigger. So there's a new feature that you can just zoom into the thing and make it bigger so I don't have to. Alright, so the basic idea is that I'm going to be pulling the mouse, and then anytime the horizontal position of the mouse changes, I'm going to read through this table, and this thing over here, it says it's frequency A and frequency B and so forth. In general, this organization, which makes sense if you actually are interested in how the thing works, is not the same organization that you'd want if you were going to evaluate whether it's got the magic that you're seeking. And in particular, what you're looking for in something like this is, what can I control, and what's interesting to manipulate? And I think of that question of what to control and what you want to manipulate as basically a kind of story that you're going to tell yourself. In other words, you don't think of the work that you're doing in terms of the fact that they're objects with particular names connected in a particular way, but rather you think about how can I change things, and how is that, how am I going to organize what I change over time? And then you also want sort of a model of those changes and those things that you can change that reflects how you think about it. And this isn't it. So the first solution that we had in Max for a long time was that you could just unlock your patch and hide a bunch of stuff like this. And you could say hide unlock for all those objects. And then when you lock the patch, they would disappear. Of course, you have to remember to do it to the patch cords too, but you know, you can do that. But in Max 5, we have this new thing, which is called presentation mode. And that lets you change the position of some boxes, but not others, and only show those things that you think are part of the user interface, in a sense, of what you're doing. So I just click on this icon down here, which is supposed to look like a chart of sales going up. And now only the objects that are important to me have been included, and they've been organized in some logical way. So in this case, this is a feedback FM system, and I have tables that I can draw to represent a kind of control curve for the frequency and amplitude of the two oscillators. So, just to demonstrate what this sounds like. Oh, you know, one thing is that the most important thing somehow got lost, which is that I need to switch. Oh, I said hide unlock, and so they got, so I have to show them. All right, so there they are. Okay, so turn this on. It's very low volume because it gets really loud. Numbers here, and now it'll finally make some sound. That's what usually happens in any demo. Let's see how we're doing now. Okay. This number should be about. It's not really doing anything, is it? Basically suggests that I have misidentified the things. But I want to show you how I could figure that out. So in addition to having this other view of your patch, you can also have a separate view. So I can have this one in the other mode. And let's make sure everything is visible here. And then we have tools so that you can see the relationship between them. So in particular, I'm interested in why this number so when I select this, then you can see that that shows up here as we call that tinging, so that you can, and if I select or move it, then it kind of shows you what you're moving. So even though these things are in different places, we try to find a way that while you're looking at two different views, you can establish a connection between them. So, what did I do that was so wrong in cleaning this up? Because it worked a minute ago. So this is mislabeled, and that should be over here. So that was correct. It's really hard to know what's wrong with this. Let me try one more thing, and then we'll move on.
The amplitude of the output just above the slider.
Yes.
It's something like 3,000.
Yes. That seems rather high.
A little bit.
I move this.
The table. It's the table range.
Yes. But it's not changing.
In a graph.
So this should be
just one.
It should be one. Oh. Okay, now I understand how this works. Okay. So, let's try it again. So, basically, these are the things that I'm supposed to move, and I never did. Now I think we can get a little louder. It's still like really lame. Well, anyway. The other thing that I should have done, and you can tell I don't really use the program enough, is made some kind of preset so that at least I started with good conditions. And I was just saying a minute ago that I should make it easier for people to get started with things. And so you can see that I should just listen to my own advice. The goal here, which I've completely sort of shown as kind of bogus, but anyway, the goal is that in this cycle that I'm talking about, that once you actually get this set up and working properly, you can go from this side of thinking over to this side almost simultaneously, so that you can use the thing that you've made and treat it in this evaluative sense on this side over here, and then over on the right side you can work on the structure, and based on what the evaluation has told you about what you need to do, you can change the structure. And I want to show you one more example of this same algorithm, but I've done it in a slightly different way, which is with subpatchers. So this one, just make sure this one doesn't get really loud too. So this one responds to the mouse and has three instances of that particular thing that I showed, but they've been put into these little subpatchers here. So that's nice, but traditionally, if you had decided to put the work that you have in a sun patcher was basically frozen. You could change it, but you couldn't actually listen to the change inside the sun patcher because there's no way to edit it. You could edit a copy of it, and then the other ones would update when you changed that copy, but the actual editing itself couldn't be done in the context of evaluating what you're doing. So, just to show you that how we changed that. So here's our thing. Now I'm actually doing this thing where I'm tracking the mouse. So basically, all the editing operations that I do are going to involve mouse movement. So I can actually hear unintentionally changes to this little patch while I'm editing the subpatch. So I open it up and I choose modify read only from the file menu here. And then that lets me unlock the patch. And I can actually make changes to it in here. And what I'm going to do is change one of these cycle objects to a triangle object. And it creates a little crazier sound. And now if I save this one, the other ones will change to match it. And now it has a kind of bouncy, chaotic thing. Kind of laughing at me for giving a lame demo. Okay. So, having shown you that idea, then there's one other kind of thing about the cognitive aspect of doing creative work that I think is really important to try to support, and that's what I would call fluency. And for me, fluency is all about forgetting. And if you can forget how you learned how to do something, that probably means that you can do it in a way that you don't have to think about it. So, not being forced to remember things is at least a start toward forgetting them. And so I have another little demonstration of some aspects of that. So this demo, because I wanted to subscribe to my own idea about not having to remember anything, I actually wrote down the instructions for the demo in the patch. So I'm going to follow these step by step now. So the first thing I'm going to do is make a counter object. And then I'm going to show you that if you wanted to know the messages that the counter object responded to, you can just click on the inlet that you're interested in knowing about, and you get a menu of all the messages and okay, so you get a message, and then there's this other window called the clue window, which is basically watching what you're doing with the mouse and telling you what's about to happen. But what's nice about the clue window in conjunction with this menu is that for whatever message you're interested in, it will tell you, it will read the documentation and tell you what it does. So you don't even need to open the documentation, which happens to be in the software. You can just look in the menu and read the thing that you're interested in. So if you can remember how to do this, you can forget about how these things work, basically. So I'm thinking that basically you can remember this one thing, which applies to every object more easily than you can remember the details of all these messages. All right, the next thing is you often want to know about messages that you could send to an object, but the one thing that I can remember in addition is what do you type after the word to give arguments to an object. So if I type selector into an object box, it tells me down here what this object does. But if I move the mouse into the box itself, and I'm about ready to type the arguments, it will tell me what the arguments are in the clue window. So now I know that the first one is, why is it telling me about counter? Oh, that's a bug, actually. let's start over with the new object, and then it should work. Okay, so the first argument is a number of inputs that I want for the selector. And the second one is which inlet will be basically pre-selected, if I want. So that's helpful to me, so that I can type 6 now, and I know that I'll get 6 inputs like that. Okay, I see that my directions tell me the wrong thing. All right. So I'm going to do this. Okay, so another thing that you might want to do while you're in the process of, you're in this particular context, is you might want to know what some other objects that you could type into the box and what they do. So this particular feature I think is really stupid, but we took it out of the first few versions of Max 5 and everyone complained, because it turns out that people use this list of, just the list of names of objects sorted by categories, as a way to get ideas about what to do next, which I think is just pointless. I mean, it's like looking in the dictionary to find a word that you're going to use in a sentence for something that you're writing. But it's common enough that I, you know, realize that based on this and many other things that people have told me, that this sort of cognitive stuff that I'm talking about is really important to a lot of people, that they think about using software as the site of their creativity. I used to think that before you would sit down to use Max, you were already an expert about whatever you were going to do, and you just went and did it. And there was never any kind of uncertainty or creative anxiety involved in this process. But this turns out not to be the case. So that's made me even more adamant about worrying about these tiny little details about user interface, to try to at least, you know, not break the flow of people's thinking. So anyway, there's this little icon over here that pops up this list, and then whatever you're over a particular object, again, it tells you down in the clue window a kind of a summary description of what it does. So at least that's better than just guessing about an object that you might want to use based on its name. Okay, another thing you can do is, if you really aren't sure about an object that you've made, you can select it and then say open the reference. So this opens our documentation window, and here's the basically the web-based version of our existing documentation. And you know, one thing I like about this is that there are links to other objects. So it says that this object is a version of the switch object. Well, maybe the switch object is really what you want, so maybe you should learn about that one, and you can do that. But in addition, there's a thing down here called Open Patcher. So if you want to see the help file for this, you can just click on that, and it will find the associated help file. And here you can just demo the object if you want. Hopefully, somewhat like the use of a web browser, the reference information is somewhat intelligent and gives you other things that you can look for. A similar thing here is with the C also thing. This is actually driven from the documentation and created automatically. So if you wanted to know more about selector from a tutorial perspective, you can choose MSP Tutorial 5, and that opens up here in the window. Another thing, another aspect of the documentation is that we have a list of all the objects here that are related to this particular object. So since this is an audio object, only the audio objects show up in this menu. And this menu in general is designed to show you related content to whatever the thing that you're looking at is. Okay, so being able to forget about details of how the program works by having all this information readily available is one aspect of being fluent. And another is that if you make something, you should be able to get access to your past work and reuse it easily without having to use your own system for storing it. The program should somehow facilitate that kind of thing for you. So here's one simple example. It's not new, but it's one of the first things that I did in thinking about some of these issues. So let's go back to making our counter, because that is, I'm doing the thing out of order of what I said, but no, actually, I want to do it in the right order. Sorry. Okay, so here's a button, and I'm going to open the inspector here. And where's our clue window? Yeah, here. Okay, so as you can see, that if you wanted to know what any of these things in the inspector do, they're also documented. Just when you move the mouse over them in the clue window. In particular here, what I want to do is change the outline to be orange. And now I really like this particular button, so I'm going to save it as a prototype and name it something like orange button. And now, if I want to make a new one, I have two choices. Either I can take an existing button, and then I can go and choose orange button here on with that one selected, and I get this one. Or I can go to the object palette and click on the little three above the button icon, and then I see pictorial images of all the buttons that I've made as prototypes, and I can pick the one that I want visually. So there, I don't need to remember what it looked like, whereas when I'm having to choose it by name here, I at least have to remember what it was. So again, it's a way that you don't have to imagine what you're doing. I mean, ideally, to be a really good fluent user of something, you want to have what's called predictive knowledge. You want to be able to know what's going to happen when you do any particular thing. But sometimes the program can at least help you by making it so that if you can't remember exactly what's going to happen, you have more information about the impact of your choice. Okay, so finally, there's a thing that I'm not finished working on, but you can sort of see a little bit of an example of it. And that's what I've been calling patching up. So traditionally in Macs, if you want to make a connection between two things, you go from the outlet to the inlet. And the thing is that when you start this process of going from the outlet, you don't know, the program doesn't know what you're going to do, because we kind of know what this outlet does, but we don't know where you want to go with it. And we can't really help you that much. We can show little things saying what these possible inlets that you're going to connect to might do, but we don't have a lot of information about your intention. But imagine that I have a counter here, and And I want to connect a bang to it. So you may remember that menu I just showed you. So if I actually select the bang message here, we actually patch a bang to the object now. So you don't have to make that one connection. It's kind of starting to be a bit like macros for a visual language. But I want to extend this even further, because often if you want to connect a bang, you really want to do something more like this. You want to put a metro here, and then above the metro you're going to want to put a toggle to turn the metro on and off, and then next to the right inlet you're going to want to put a number box, which is going to control the interval of the metro. And this is a pattern that people use over and over again. So why not make it so that when I choose the word bang, there's like a submenu here with a bunch of patterns that are common things that people do over and over again. Then you don't have to remember how to do it, and in one step you can do what takes maybe 13 or 14 seconds, and you can finish your patch more quickly, and artists will be more productive, and more art will be created, and people will be happier. And what's wrong with that? Those are just a few of the things that I have thought about and working on the software. I just want to mention briefly that the thing that I'm working on next, that relates to a relationship between a visual language and performance, is in computational performance. There's generally, with this system, you know, Max runs more slowly to write the same kind of program that you, if you wrote the same program in C, it'd probably run faster. And I don't really know that there's a reason why that has to be true. That's one of the main things that I'm interested in now. But not just because the programs like this run slowly. These are actually okay. There are three actual places where computational performance is important. One of them is in OpenGL and making that run on graphics processors. Another is the Arduino, which is a severely constrained computational environment with very small amounts of memory and a very slow processor. But still, as Frank said, you know, people are not that into writing C code or what is close to C code for the Arduino. And in particular, what's difficult about that is that it's impossible to debug. So we think that we can provide a visual way to program the Arduino, and also a visual way to debug what's going on with it, that wouldn't be possible if you just wrote the C code yourself. And the final place where I would like to improve performance is in audio, and taking what looks like a traditional signal graph in Max and making it into something that is actually C code. And so the thing underlying all of these ideas is the notion of translating the something in the visual domain into something that's in the source code domain, and then compiling it dynamically while Max is running, and optimizing that compilation and the set of objects that you use for this to be specific for these three areas. So there might be lots of new kinds of patch cords and lots of new groups of little objects. We haven't really figured out the design for this whole idea yet. But the goal is by rather than basically just running the graph is kind of what we do now, where you have these represent little tiny C programs that talk to each other. We would do what you might think is going on already, which is translate the graph into a visual, into a textual language. And there we can use optimization technology to improve performance. There's no optimization for max. No one cares about max and making it run faster. So if we're we're going to use the computer industry's compiler technology, we actually have to translate it to what 90% of the world does, which is write text source code. So anyone have any questions about anything at all? I'm happy to answer them for as long as you can stand listening to other people ask questions.
Asking about the boring aspect that you talked earlier. At Stein also, we talked about this, you know, when you provide a tool or for your company, you're kind of obliged to the users in a certain way, but also you have to deal, you know, you can't listen to everything they ask for. And there's that famous thing on Mac's list about the rounded boxes and square boxes and all that. And, so what is sort of the balance or the distance that you've been able to find between your user community and also as a developer of the software, what you think is the better path of the software, but also sort of listening or, you know, implementing certain things that people ask?
Well, it depends on the day, but sort of consistent with the message that I have here is that I think that what people think they want isn't what they really want. But on the other hand, I don't know that I know better what they want than they say they want. But my experience, based on my job that I had in high school, when I worked at a newspaper, and the job I had was to basically arrange pages for editors. And as much as I would try to describe what I was thinking to them, if I didn't actually do it and show them what I was thinking, they would never agree with me. And so what I find is that implementation creates its own reality. You have to actually make something in order to get feedback from people about whether it works or not. You can't just design it and then tell people what you're thinking about and get them to tell you whether they think it's a good idea or not. Similarly, if people have suggestions for you, they're almost entirely based on sort of a very immediate reaction to the implementation that you've made. So you can't really stimulate people to give you feedback unless you actually sort of make something first and give them something to talk about. So how does this relate to imposing roundedness on people who might have wanted squareness? I am not sure, but
has the debate lessened since you actually released it?
As far as I can tell, people got tired of talking about it. One of the things that people asked was, okay, well, if you're not going to change it, why don't you at least let me change it so that I can decide how rounded something is? But that that sort of defeated the purpose of the roundedness, which was to serve as a cue for identifying different objects. And so one of the things that I would do to argue against that was show people what it would look like if you could change the roundedness of certain objects so that, or you could make it so that they were all consistent. And what you would see is that, in fact, it was impossible to identify what certain objects looked like, which objects were which, based on that. So the whole thing with roundness is based on trying to give people a relatively unconscious level cue about what objects did what. And you might think this is really stupid, but it turns out that when people are first learning the program, they have a really hard time making a distinction between an object and a message. And so it was my goal at least to make the default appearance of those things extremely different from each other. Because in the old version, the only difference was that one had two lines at the top and the other had one line. And it's actually, I think, cognitively difficult for people to tell the difference between something with one line and something with two lines. So maybe the whole thing is, you know, really arrogant and a failure. But it was at least there was some thought behind it. I wasn't just trying to be arbitrary. Yeah.
I can't help but notice the late in life. On the dock, and a little while ago there was a thing on the Cycling 74 website about a strategic alliance between Cycling 74 and, you know, people making life. Is there anything happening? Because there hasn't seemed to sort of be anything coming from it yet.
January 14, 2009.
Okay, all right.
I'm not
going to
say anything before that.
January 14, 2009.
But I guess the other thing I would say is, you know, a lot of the things that are in Max 5 will make a lot more sense on January 14th. At least that's the way I think about it. And the project we've actually been working on for over 2 years. So it's. I hope that it will appear as non-trivial to you as it does to us.
You gonna do any price funding discounts? Like, you know, you buy Max 5, get money off it with the night and vice versa, is that?
Yes.
Okay.
It depends on who you are. That's how all software works.
I'm a student.
So if you're a student, it's something like $300 for Okay, $250. And if you're not a student, it's $699. And it used to be $850. So it's trending toward free.
It's going to take a while.
I mean, it would be cool if it were free. I don't know how that would. How that would work, but it could happen.
Commercials would pop up, you know, regular intervals.
I learned about the earlier version of Max, and now that I see the new kind of interface, I'm much more interested to use the program, because somehow the interface speaks more to me, like, in terms of user-friendly and simplicity.
Well, I hope that you won't be offended if I tell you this, but part of my interest, and I don't know that it was anything explicit that that we tried to do in this particular version exactly, but it really concerns me that 98% of the user base of this program is male. And, So their you know, roundedness may have something to do. you'll notice that the only people in our community that complained about the roundness were male. And I actually think that based on the content of some of their comments, that there is a definite thing where their somehow their gender identity is being threatened by the shape of some elements of the user interface. So, but you know, I think that the general problem with the field being dominated by one gender is a larger problem than just the user interface of this software. But hopefully this won't hurt that pursuit of getting more women interested in the field. And if any of you have any other ideas of things that, you know, not just programming ideas, but you know, program ideas, basically, I would definitely be interested in hearing them and finding ways to support people who are looking at that problem. Yeah.
Are there any? Because are there any specific hooks into links with other software, like for presentation purposes? I can remember, you know, the installation that I made with Michel in the museum. We, you know, it was just a nightmare trying to have it work with Flash, and we ended up ditching Flash in the end altogether, because Flash would be eating up all the processing power, and you know, it's just like horrible. It would work for like 15 minutes and then crash, and the next time it would work for 5 minutes and then crash. And then I can remember, you know, we were designing the whole thing within X, which was sort of okay, you know, it has some more limitations, of course, than Flash, but it was actually, you know, quite nice, but it had lots of weird quirks in terms of how you would lay out the screens, and if then an object popped up and you edited the object, the whole screen removed like 3 pixels, and, you know, stuff like that. Is there any, because I've been hearing people, you know, talk about, it's interesting to make these Mac specials, but, you know, it's difficult to present them in like an audience-friendly form, for instance, you know, for installations or, you know, these kinds of things. Are there any more hooks in Max 5 for stuff like that?
Manuel, do you want to say something about, sorry to wake you up, but, so you tried to use Flash inside of Max, is that?
Me?
Yeah.
That's what we ended up with.
But it does have a web browser object, so whatever you can do with HTML and any kind of web plugin, you can do that inside of Max. And if you're really motivated, you can actually communicate between the page and Max. That's what we're doing with, for example, controlling the documentation window. And actually, let me say that a different way. So you can actually control Max from the page. That's probably a better way of looking at it. So.
Sorry, I don't use Max with this. Is the standalone mode or the ability to build the standalone, has it been changed with the presentation mode presented?
Well, you can have the standalone open in the with your presentation if you want. So if you know, it would be sad if you had to design your user interface and then force people to switch from the ugly patch into the nice looking presentation. So you can make it so that the application that you make opens in this nice user interface that you design. aspects of building and managing applications that we're currently hope we're in the process of improving for a revision that will come out in a few months that should make it less of a hassle to deal with large projects and applications that encompass lots of patches and things like that. And that probably wouldn't apply to you if you're just starting to, you know, just getting into the software, but for people who've been using it for a long time, these are places where the performance of the program is annoying, so I'm trying to deal with that.
I noticed the C SDK is out recently, but as far as I'm aware, Pluggo still isn't can't make VSTs in Max 5. Is that functionality you're going to add soon?
Well, to see what happens on January 14th, 2009, yes. That might make it clear why the answer to that question.
Comment on the topic of fluency. One program that I've used a lot, I suppose other people have, but is Mathematica. And, like, you know, I have a degree in math as well. But if you use that program, you notice that there's no use of shortcuts in the names of functions. So, for example, you want to rotate something that's called rotation transform. And so there's a lot of, like, long spelling out of things and use of the full normative sort of name. So I find that system to be like sort of the most fluent of any programming language for me, because I already know what things are called and I can just guess at the names of functions because it's all in standard vocabulary. And sometimes when I look at Max, I'm tempted to just rename everything to something else, and I wonder if you ever have that desire.
No, that's a really interesting observation. I mean, only in Max 5 now we have this auto-completion, so you can type the first few letters of something and then it will fill in the rest of it. And I'd like to extend that to other things. So not just telling you what the arguments are, for example, but actually making it sort of dimly highlighted when you're about to type the 6, it would say, you know, number of inputs or something like that. The TOPS operating system in 1975 had that kind of thing, so why can't we put that into a program in 2008? So I guess now that we have auto-completion, I could see that being helpful. The thing is that changing the names of all the objects would violate criterion number 3. We have to figure out some way in which the long names and the short names can somehow exist in parallel. So I'll think about that.
From what I read, you're using the Juice framework in the version of Max, and that runs on Max, Windows, Mac, and Linux. Is there any interest in making that the Linux version?
There's a lot of interest in that, and that's one of the reasons that we chose that. And the first thing we'd probably do is not have any kind of editing on Linux, but just allow it to be a place where you could run patches.
Yeah, kind of deploy your audio.
And in particular, we're really interested in for the ubiquitous computing field, a very small, inexpensive Linux-based machines. And what we probably allow for in that kind of scenario is the ability to actually program the machine over a network, so that you could